Go.
Okay, so for those of you who are joining us on the Facebook Live transmission of this August event, we just seen a screening of Ancestral created by these three folks here and a variety of other puppeteers and others. And now we want to have a discussion with y'all. This event is being recorded, well, by Bart Rockleburton, the director of the Puppet Arts Program, who faithfully records all of these events in addition to all the other amazing work he does as the director of that program. Also, we have from Wyndham, CTV 192, a community public access TV station, right?
Yep.
Recording this for later broadcast. So we're really happy that we have with us this evening, on the far, far right from the audience, Helder Mira, independent filmmaker from Hartford, who has worked for the City of Hartford, Public Access Television, Robert Ears Media, Greater Hartford Arts Council, Wadsworth Athenaeum. He has worked in a variety of different film projects and of all different sorts. He's currently the multimedia producer for the Office of Communications at Trinity College, where he produces videos about the work of the college's students, faculty, and alumni. And next to him, plugging in her computer, is Sarah Nolan, puppeteer and filmmaker, originally from Austin, Texas. And Sarah has an MFA degree from Puppet Arts at UConn, which is a good advertisement for the program, and a bachelor's degree in cinema television from Southern Methodist University. She is currently the Puppet Showplace Theater's resident artist, and she created a show recently called The Fairy Tailor, which is going to be featured as part of our fall performance series here. Sarah's had extensive work in television and film. Her television pilot, Treeples, which was her master's project, I believe, was has been screened at many film festivals, and she was the recipient of the Mr. Rogers Memorial Scholarship, which is great. And finally, Paul Spirito, for a while, was an industrial designer in the toy industry, and then entered UConn's Puppet Arts Graduate Program, and after which he became the Puppetry Technical Supervisor. He's about to increase his participation in the Puppet Arts Program as a artist professor in residence.
We'll see.
Okay, we hope. And runs the online program of instruction for puppetry at the Puppet Arts Program. So Paul writes that he hopes to push the art of puppetry forward by infusing traditional forms and techniques with 21st century materials and processes. Paul is also the founder of the Hartford Art Sled Derby, which is this amazing event celebrating the art of going downhill and strange contraptions. So we're very excited that you all are here. And I thought to ask of each of you, just to begin this discussion, which we later want to expand and include you all, I wanted to ask each of you what exactly you did in the film. I think a lot of us aren't necessarily familiar with all of what goes on in an amazing film like this. So many people are in the credits and we see the results, but here's an opportunity to have a behind the scenes look. So maybe I would ask Helder, what exactly is it that you do and did in this film?
So basically my job was lighting the set and running the camera and setting up the shots, or setting up the framing, which I collaborated with Paul quite a bit about to see how he wanted the shots to look. And after that, after the initial production, also doing the editing and the post-production aspect of it, coloring it, color grading it. After it was all set, I was watching two shots that I need to fix. And then also laying down the audio.
Two shots.
Anyway, it was.
And a lot of support. I want to say that you guided me.
Sure, sure. We'll go with that one. I yelled at them a lot. I think that was a bit of it. And Sarah yelled at me a lot to like get on schedule and stay. I think that's what she does. So.
I didn't yell at anybody.
Really. No yelling.
That was my job. Yeah. I started out as the storyboard artist, so I basically made a rough sketch of all of the shots we were thinking after looking through the scripts. I weeded through it and made a shot. I have them here, and I could show them to you all on the screen if my computer charges. But yes, we had all of these storyboards, and so each scene had a set. And then Paul and I, you know, collaborated on that after doing a rough sketch. And then I was also the assistant director, which means it was my job to coordinate everything, keep things moving, do the shot list, create a schedule from the storyboards into a shot list, make sure all of our props were lined up and ready to go for every scene, make sure we had puppeteers for every scene, you know, basic coordination and managing. So I think my job was basically to make sure that the only thing Paul was doing was either directing puppets and or working with Helder. That was my goal.
Well, first of all, I wanted to recognize there's a lot of people in the audience right now who helped out in the film. Raise your hand if you had something to do with this film. Right, so thank you all. Especially all three voices of the three speaking characters in the film. Noelle, who is Marsan, the mysterious Oracle Yoda character. Caleb, who is the village leader, gives the dramatic speeches. And John Cody in the orange hat, who is the star of the film.
What did I do?
I conceived and wrote and raised some money, and then I was smart enough to bring these two on the project. And then I, because they did their job so well, I was able to help create the art that we all saw. Wrote and directed and designed and all the things in the list.
I wanted to ask about the storyline a little bit, because I know that it deals, it's a story with birds, but then I think you wrote about the sort of larger implications of the story, not to put too much weight on it, but you know, it's on the one hand, it's a puppet film; it's just a bunch of birds in the woods.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, it's dealing with generations and father-son relationships. And I mean, is it fair to go in that direction? And you know, do we take this seriously as well as taking it for its beauty and excellentness?
It wasn't intentional at the time when I was writing it, because I wrote it in 2013. But I was just noticing that it sort of speaks against the nationalist movement that's happening in our country right now, that these puppets are sort of, they've isolated themselves in this little village in the forest, and Byrne is hopefully like breaking that spell and getting them to return to their sort of outgoing, worldly ways.
I remember there was some climate change stuff, right?
There's climate change stuff, yeah, that was inspiring. But more the most was, I was reading a lot of Joseph Campbell, who talks about the hero story, and I really wanted to tell a Star Warsian traditional hero's journey, and this was sort of my version of it.
Well, he's a maker, and you're a maker.
He's a maker. He's trying to bring that back to his culture also.
There's a nice parallel there.
And of course, Joseph Campbell's Hero of a Thousand Faces was a direct influence on the whole Star Wars cycle.
Right.
His son, Lucas
yeah,
was specifically thinking of sort of.
Right, and they actually collaborated on the,
right.
on the writing of the script.
Mm-hmm.
the sort of facetious question I had said I wanted to ask you was, why make a puppet film? And I was reminded of a friend of mine from Brennan Puppet Theater in a television interview in Philadelphia or Baltimore. Someone said, why the big puppets? And he said, I don't know, why not? Which is, in a way, as good an answer as any. But I was wondering about puppet films. Like Helder, I don't know if you don't always work with puppets, you work with films. Sarah, I was going to ask you, you know, you started, I don't know if you started with film and then got into puppets, or if you went to puppets and got into film. And then Paul, I know for, you know, the wide range of things you do with puppetry, but at a certain point, you know, you decided to make a film instead of a live show. So why make a puppet film?
Why not? I mean, I got my start freshman year of college. I was working with animation, and speaking of Star Wars, actually like took some like animate, like some little figures like Star Wars and G.I. Joes and like animated them like through stop motion. So it's always been, I mean, cartoons, Muppets, everything has always been part of my life, and one of the inspirations for me getting into film and producing. So the idea of, you know, Paul said, let's do this. I'm like, sure, why not? Like, it was kind of a no-brainer, but I always wanted to do it. I also, having worked with actors, was a nice way to be artistic and not have to deal with actors. especially the puppeteers. No, the puppeteers are great. Yeah.
But I was going to ask you, I don't know if I should, to elaborate on that. Puppets are different than actors.
Their puppets are actually more temperamental. Puppets or human puppets or meat puppets are a little bit easier to work with sometimes, but because when you want them to like keep their head straight, they'll keep their head straight or bob it and like fall over when you don't want them to, like those guys. But
what about you, Sarah? How did you come into puppet film in particular?
I was a kid making puppets in my room, but I was too terrified to perform them live. I would do little things like puppet book reports, and I would always try to make class projects into a puppet. and I realized that, you know, I got into filmmaking in high school, so it was always puppets, film. And I started doing a lot of documentary type filmmaking in high school, but also making puppet video shorts, just, you know, in my room, and sometimes I would get my friends to come in and play certain parts, or I did a music video and of a Shin song and just some odd stuff, and I was like, oh, I should go to film school so I can learn how to film my puppets. And I went to SMU, and all of my film projects have puppets in them, and so I became known as the puppet lady there. And then my senior project in film school was a children's TV pilot. It was very, very short. It was 8 minutes. It was called ABC Detectives. And then what I love about and what draws me into puppets and film is that you can basically infuse magic into an everyday live world environment. And Ancestral does this really, really well, where it's actually taking the palette of our of an outdoor location, or you're on the street, or you're actually in a real world environment and infusing fantasy so simply by just having a puppet there, because it's this magical being that doesn't normally exist in our everyday world. I wish it did, but and so I think that's what I love about it. And there's some shows that do that through animation. I know the series Gumball has a lot of photo realistic backdrops, but animation in front. So I believe that puppetry is a way to actually, instead of it being a flat layer in a live world environment, you can actually have three-dimensional beings inside a live environment. So that's what I love, the depth that it gives and that element of fantasy. Where it's all incorporated. And then, so
I just want to go film in the woods, like, mm-hmm. Mohammed's Puppets. I was like, that sounds awesome. Let's do that. And, like,
it was
kind of play with, like, the, like, daylight and everything, all the scenery.
It was a retreat.
It was.
I mean, we were filming for 8 days. So, we were 8 days out in the woods.
We were really only inside, like, a day and a half.
Mm-hmm.
Making live puppet theater, live theater in general, it's you know, they say that the beauty of live theater is that you never know what it's going to be, and it's going to be different every time, just because that's the nature of live theater. Well, I need a little more control than that. I like a little more control. I wanted to say, okay, now I want you to look at the back of this puppet's head. Now I want you to see this. Now I want you to see that. And film is the only way to do that, to be very so specific that you're controlling the viewer's eyeball.
Yeah, and the story is a film. I don't know.
Do you think the story is a film?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of it. It could be a stage show.
It's great.
I think it works. It works better as film just because you have all those locations and seeing down into the water well. Really just nice imagery.
Yeah, you know, it's those things like the shots down into the water tank that, you know, it would be harder and you wouldn't be able to control your audience the way I refer to.
Just all those trees, just like, that's what I love is you're looking at, it's just trees forever.
John, like that last shot was so little over the trees with the drone. Watching the trees just like swim in a way, like they're
right.
Like so alive,
it's like the
just adding to it. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So it's, I mean, you don't get that on stage.
Was that a drone? Did you just say was that a drone shot?
Yeah, sure.
We may have had some rules.
It's a small
helicopter. We put it on burn.
The opening shot
and that last shot where the
bird's
ending
eye view,
the narration. Yeah.
You would earlier said you wanted to make sure to mention the nature of this as a project that involved the students.
Yeah.
And what was that like? How did that Sarah just talked about the sort of retreat. That quality of the 8 days of working together, which sounds fascinating. Did this involve a lot of teaching, or was it? And did that
it didn't.
In a way,
it didn't involve a lot of teaching, but I think we all learned an incredible amount.
I did the etiquette workshop.
You did a lot of teaching. You did a lot. Both of you did a lot of teaching. Anyway.
Oh yeah.
There are students in the audience. Did you guys learn a lot from us? Okay, liars.
I really want to thank Bart because, and most of all the students, because I don't think anyone earned credit except for maybe Sarah. But there was so much involvement. Everybody, because, you know, sometimes school can get a little bit monotonous with the classes and the projects and the this and the that. And I was like, hey, I'm going to shoot this film this particular week in October, and I need help.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody, there was just an amazing turnout to say, okay, we're there.
Yeah.
You know,
that was the great thing, seeing like the students just really turn out to like help you and like,
yeah.
Really be dedicated in helping
right.
The program and the project.
And we shot most of the film, you know, on the Depot campus, which is where the Puppet Lab is, and the set was maybe 200 yards away from the Puppet Lab itself.
Mm-hmm.
So every morning we'd lug everything out there into the woods and set it up with a generator and lights and camera and puppets and
action.
Yeah.
Well, and what was great about having it being a puppet film is that even though we, you know, we're shooting 8 full days, no one in school can actually come and
yeah.
skip classes and be there for 8 days. So because it's a puppet film, we literally had people changing hands with
right.
puppets. So even if we needed one puppet to be in the shots for the whole day, we were able to have students come in an hour, 2 hours at a time, whenever they could, and that was really
every
fun.
Puppet character in the film is performed by at least 3 different people.
Yeah, just we can schedule. And
yeah.
So that was a real strength of
everyone
it being a puppet film.
Yeah, that's true.
You mentioned, Sarah, a little earlier that the difference between a film like this puppet film, Ancestral, and you talked about depth, and I think your comparison was to digital imagery,
mm-hmm.
and I wondered what the differences are for you guys between filming, making a film with live puppetry, and say stop motion animation or CGI, which you mentioned, digital effects. Are there certain advantages to these different media? Obviously, you've liked working with live puppet film
mm-hmm.
technique here, but I'm thinking from a kind of, maybe it's a technical perspective, how do we think of those differences? Because sometimes people say, well, you could just do that with CGI, or you might, I don't know what you might think of the advantages of stop motion versus live film, probably
mm-hmm.
you have maybe a bit more control, but are those differences important at all, and if so, what are they? What are the important differences?
In filming-wise, like filming puppets is a lot less problematic, I'd say, than stop motion, which is like one frame at a time, and like moving everything very gently to make sure you get that fluid motion. Whereas this, like, I love seeing just they're natural. They look like you're moving them. They're moving in real time. There's none of that. I mean, there's a beauty to stop motion that you can't compare. And as far as like CGI, like, yeah, you can get anything in CGI nowadays. I don't work with CGI, so I don't really have that much of a comparison. But other than, you know, watching all the CGI movies you want, like, you're going to get whatever natural and realistic, almost realistic, but I feel like there's a beauty to like the puppet and like seeing like there's like the blue fur that she selected, Paul, like just like sparkling off of like the sun naturally just looks a lot more beautiful than say seeing it created digitally.
Yeah.
And there's happy accidents, I think, that you just don't get as easily. Yeah, the live candles. And I just remember trying to direct a shot, and you know, there was the main puppet, his neck was really finicky. So occasionally something would go wrong and his head was just drooping. and occasionally it'd be like, okay, I want you to look down, you know, or I don't know what is going to happen. You just do the shot, and then the puppet would speak his line, and then he'd be like, we ended up using that shot, you know. We didn't do that on purpose, but it turned out to be just right. And that's, you know, those things you wouldn't get in a more deliberate medium like stop motion or CGI.
Yeah, once you incorporate, you know, compositing shots and CGI, you know, all of that has to be very, very planned. I think we're entering a world now where we can like live capture puppetry being animated by, you know, an actual puppeteer.
What how do you mean? Like motion capture?
Yeah, like motion capture. And I think that's, you know, getting progressively faster and more.
You mean like a live performance, motion capture?
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, there's still something about being out in a live environment that you just can't.
Right.
Some of my favorite shots are the shots of Burn and Marzahn, like with the sun setting in the back, which you can't get. I mean, you can get it. You can create it digitally, but like, it's so much nicer to see it naturally happen.
And
some of my favorite memories are from those couple hours at the end of the day,
we're
running around like maniacs.
Get it! Get
the light! The light! Go! The light!
There's a lot of yelling.
has not been, my work has not been so much in puppets for film or for the camera, but and I know one of the great things about the Puppet Arts Program is that it does offer such a wide variety of opportunities to learn about many different types of puppet performance, including the varieties of film and animation. But what are the differences between operating puppets, performing puppets for the camera, and performing puppets for a live audience? Are you thinking about what you're doing differently? Is your frame of mind a little bit different? Is your sense of what's going on with the puppet different when you're working with a camera or live?
Absolutely. With live performance, you have to rehearse so that the muscles of your body know the performance, right? Muscle memory, and your mind knows your performance of both dialogue and movement, and you go out there and you hope for the best. With video and with film, we really didn't have to do that much live rehearsal. We did a little bit of rehearsal just to get to know the way the puppet moves, but then we took it shot by shot, really. Okay, this is what your puppet is doing in this particular shot. Let's do a quick rehearsal just to see what that's like. And okay, that looked great. Let's shoot it. That looked great. Or no, let's try it again. Try this, do that, try that. And then we get all that in the camera, and then we move on to the next shot. And then so you get all these opportunities to try different things. And then you get back to the editing room, and Helder and I are sitting there, and oh, let me look at that one. Oh, let me look at that one. Maybe we could use that there. We could use this here. Oh, that's a good one. Oh, I thought that was a terrible one that day we were shooting. But yeah, let's use that one. It looks great. So there's all these opportunities to pick and choose.
The work goes into, like, this was our shot list for the whole film. And I'm so glad I saw this. I take this
up.
I didn't know I still had it. I actually displayed this up on my MFA table. this was our shot list. So the story, it's just a totally different storytelling mindset where you are breaking the story apart into visual moments or actions. And I think when you're filming with puppets versus humans, it's so different because with human actors, everything relies on, like with film acting, it's so subtle. It's like a quivering lip, or you know, the hand gestures are very minimal. Whereas in theater, everything has to be so much bigger. So taking the idea of film acting into a puppet, it's more about what can the puppets do? And I think some of the shots that in the ancestral, that where they are at their best is when, you know, the oracle Marcelin puts her hand on Bird's shoulder and says, right, like that's an action that we found that worked really well. And I think breaking apart, you know, the story into just like visual moments is more important than trying to, you know, I am a puppeteer creating this kid, right? Because you might be switching hands, you know what I mean? You might have another student coming in 30 minutes to grab that puppet.
Like the shot where just before Burns' father dies, we had the little kid puppet and we had the father.
Oh, yeah.
And I think
we were arguing about
like,
this.
Sarah was like, he should run over and hug him. And I was like, no, that's not what I wrote. That's not, I'm not doing that. And she was like, let's just try. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna try it. And then she tried it, and we were all like, oh, God.
And the whole audience, too, was like, oh. And then this one's like, we also argued about the, when the father jumps off and Vern is sad.
Right. don't have time for that. It's fine the way it is. That was me on set. I was just always freaking out, like, we're running out of time.
Yeah.
These guys were like, calm down. We can do this. Just let me figure this out. And I love
that. Yeah, because because that's the thing with life poetry, or, you know, life world, life puppet, is that you will run out of time because the sun is going down.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask a question about structure, I think, and maybe later ask about the time frame for the different elements of the film, but how much of a difference is there between the structure of the shots as defined in your storyboard and then what Helder ended up creating when you edited the film, I guess maybe together with Paul and maybe with Sarah, but how much of a difference is there between what you started out thinking about and what you ended up with?
I'd say it's pretty solid. It's pretty much what Paul had in mind originally.
Did we make a major, I don't know if this was before we started shooting, but I didn't exactly know where that memory sequence would go.
The memory sequence was an issue.
We
started.
So you probably scrambled some stuff.
Yeah, we moved it around a bit.
Reassembled, which makes sense.
You know, the course of 4 years has been kind of complicated. It's around what we did.
Yeah, but I think I had the memory much later in the film. And then we were watching the rough cut, and I'm like, no one's going to know what's going on. They need this information earlier, and so then we started shuffling things around.
I think it started with the memory. Initially, it started with the memory. It started with the backstory, and then it was complicated. So then we decided to do the
storyboard.
We decided to do it as a story.
Yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. So anyway, I guess the point is that it evolves.
It evolved like from writing to shooting to editing. There are a couple pieces we did. Just a little bit extra. Beating up on grounders early on.
Yeah, and there was a ton of stuff that we shot that didn't get into the film.
How often did you shoot scenes? How many takes did you do for a particular scene?
More than five, I don't think. Unless it was a really complicated move with the puppet.
Yeah, like the part where the takeoff, both takeoffs, for the father and with Byrne, Mark Blashford, who was a grad student here, he's a very tall, skinny guy with really long arms. So he was performing that marionette, and he was standing on this stepladder, and I think we had like a rope tied around his waist, or somebody was holding him from falling, and he was leaning way out, and he was doing this thing, and we just kept doing it, and it's just not quite right. And Mark's like, oh my God, I can't do this anymore. And we were like, come on, a couple more times.
That was a particularly difficult one because there are times when we wanted it at a certain level and the marionette would come into shot at the very end.
The strings were only so long, so the puppet was in shot, but then we needed it to dip out of shot. But in order for it to dip out of shot, you'd see the controller. So we were like, let's put longer strings on. No, we don't have time. You know? It was a very stressful experience.
But in editing, I mean, Paul and I stuck pretty close to what he and Sarah had storyboarded. I think we pretty much got it as it was. I don't think it's that different than what we had.
Well, because there are so many shots, we didn't have a lot of long takes that we needed to rely on one shot for this whole sequence.
Right.
So because it's cut up so much, we're seeing feet and we're seeing. You know, that's one thing about filming puppets is because there's going to be either a hand controlling it at some point or a rod, you know, the challenge is always hiding the puppets here. And so in order to kind of fill in for the audience the whole puppet, the full Monty, you know, it's helpful with shots to, like, have feet walking so we can actually see a part. And then our minds, we kind of add those pieces together and we can actually see the whole bird. And what's great about Ancestral is it uses rod puppetry and marionettes. So the marionettes are used when we have flying. And I think that was cool.
There's a whole genre of film, not criticism, but what people talk about in films is like the mistakes, like when you see a vapor trail in a Western set in the 19th century. But, and then sometimes in this film, you see strings that are operating the puppets. Not so much sometimes rods, but so what, you know, if someone said, oh, wait a minute, I saw a string, would that, is that a problem for you? And while you were answering that, maybe I'll re-plug in your computer, which is...
I have never been in a puppet film and someone comes up to me and is like, it was great, but I saw rods.
Yeah, and also, we're not pretending they're not puppets.
That was the original thought, was like, you're going to see them, you're going to see the strings. I mean, the big thing was just,
that's the charm.
We just didn't want to see the, like, controller during the marriage.
Yeah.
That was the only one that was
on.
You want
to see anybody's hand or head.
And the whole, like, montage of them building stuff, you can see, like, the rods, you can see us kind of, like, floating. You know,
right.
Here's this one piece coming in.
And what I was thinking, I hope this worked out, is that if the viewer sees the rod and it ruins the film for him, then maybe it's not a good puppet film.
Let's be honest, y'all knew that you were puppets.
Yeah,
right?
We're not fooling anybody. They're puppets, and if we can keep the life of the puppet in the shot, no one's going to care.
Well, I think it's kind of nice that it is about the maker, and you kind of do see the mechanics of the puppetry because you make them, and you're a maker. And you use, you know, pretty amazing techniques in order to make those puppets.
And there's enough, like, humanity into, like, for, like, human little moments, like, with the little kid, little baby puppy kind of lowering its head and hugging. I think that you get away with showing that, you know, they're more than just puppets.
Right, and I think that, for lack of a better word, humanity, like, when you go, oh, I think that is increased because, you know, it's a puppet. You know, it's sort of like the stuffed animal.
I wanted to ask another question. I was thinking, like, oftentimes as a puppeteer, one of the surprising questions you get after a show, like, is someone, it always surprises me anyways, how long did it take to make that puppet? And you try to figure it out and make some answer. But how long did it take to make this film? And by that I mean, like, the development of the story, how long did Sarah work on the storyboards? The shooting, I think you said, was 8 days, but there was building of puppets and sets, and then afterwards, Helder was working on editing the footage. How long did each of those processes take?
It's hard to say. It's hard to say because this was one of many projects we were working on for all of us. You know, I was working a full-time job, Sarah was going to school full-time, Helder was doing all kinds of projects. And
I will say I stopped what I was doing, and I worked only on this for 2 weeks.
Yeah, you weren't supposed to do that.
Rebel. No, I did stop, and I remember storyboarding took about, you know, we were 3-4 days, and I remember, you know, taking the time. It took about 2 full days to lay everything out after storyboards and start labeling shots, because it goes from storyboards, then you're numbering shots, and then you're organizing those shots by location, and then you're organizing those location shots by starting with your wides. And so that, you know, that just takes so much time. And then to have, you know, a document like this after a week was really important, because then I could go into this and pull scenes and what props we need just for these locations, and everything is, you know, is in one place.
Were you working from a scenario that Paul wrote, or were you just
a script?
A script. So you wrote a script. How many pages was the script?
I don't know.
I think it was
12.
12
pages.
10 to 12.
Yeah, and it was, you know, it's a puppet video. It's a puppet film script, so it's has a lot of visual information and descriptions of what things look like, as well as the dialogue and all that kind of stuff.
the building, the puppet building and the set building, was that a whole, for example, a semester, a 12, 14 week period? Was it just you?
It was about 2 months of working on it on and off. I designed the bird parts in the computer, and then I 3D printed each part.
By the bird parts, you mean the heads, or which parts?
There was the head, and then the lower beak, and then the torso, and then the two arms, and the hands, and then the two parts of the legs. So I 3D printed all of those each in halves, so that I could have a wall thickness part. And then I made silicone molds of all of those parts. And then I did color castings of those in a dark brown, so that in case some of that showed through their skin, it wouldn't be a problem. So then there's about 12 puppets altogether.
Speaking of which, feel free to come up after we're done and touch and feel and play and perform the puppets.
I went through quite a few designs of their village. It's kind of like another Star Wars influence, a sort of Ewok village kind of thing, but a little less complicated. And I found that woven natural fabric. It was like from you buy it to wrap your tiki bar. And so then I made their houses with a lot of help from students. And then Krista Weltner, who was another grad student, she took on costuming all the puppets. Because if there's one thing that I would do differently, it would be to make each puppet character in the film look a little bit different, a little bit more different. Because in my mind I was saying, oh, these are birds. Birds all look the same. You see two cardinals, they look exactly the same. So my guys have to look exactly the same and will differentiate with their costumes. It really didn't come through as much as I wanted to. And now I think that maybe the two cardinals don't look the same. Maybe one cardinal looks at the other cardinal and sees a totally different thing. So, yeah.
Do you want to talk about these images in the
showing? Yeah, Krista did custom do that. I also did on-set photography during the shoot, and so I have a lot of different photos. This is Anatar Puppeteri. So yeah, we were in a lot of different locations. So the whole set is built up so the puppeteers can manipulate from below.
There's Mark with his long arms.
Long arms Mark.
That guy's blowing that silly horn. Christopher Mullen.
That's a good view from.
Yeah, we're constantly trying to figure out ways to make the puppets look like they're standing on the platform.
You should talk about your platform puzzle piece that you made.
Oh yeah. So the main square of the village. Oh wait, no, it wasn't the main square. It was the interior shots.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. So I made this main frame. You can see it there, and then it has all these slats that are like the decking. But then it had all these little windows in it, or not windows, more like trap doors. Mm-hmm. So you can take out a piece of that decking and then insert a puppet, and then with the proper camera angle, there's a shot of it there. You see how these are all staggered so that when you put that piece back in, it blends in with the rest of the decking. But it was a constant struggle to figure out how to get the shot you wanted with as much of the character in it, but still not see the puppeteer.
And we used that decking in different places. Like, you took that puzzle piece out, and when he's looking at the maps on the floor, that's what he's being used. So it's a lot of
random leg laying on the ground.
The horror.
Right, and then we would say, oh, we need a little piece of floor, and we'd take the trap door and just put it wherever we needed it.
Mm-hmm.
less than an hour, we were set up and ready to shoot inside. We had a really productive day.
Oh, yeah. And all the sound was recorded later. Oh, you can also, this is a good shot of a viewing monitor. When puppeteers work on a film set, they have to be able to see what they're doing. What's difficult about this is that it's usually in reverse, because they are seeing what the audience will see. And so it's a little bit of...
Take my bird shirt.
John went on to make a bird show.
And the one thing was that we shot, it was like the 18th of October or the 10th of October when we started. We shot for 8 days. The forest was completely different on the 8th day of shooting than it was on the first day of shooting,
mm-hmm.
just because the leaves were falling so fast.
Yeah.
That it was crazy. So then and we didn't shoot in order. So it was really tricky to...
You have to glue the leaves back.
Yeah.
It did,
because there was more and more sun shining.
And that rain, there was a rainstorm that
knocked a bunch of leaves out. And they're shaking. See, as this branch, that branch was very important. If we wanted it to appear as if there was more leaves than there was, Shane would come in and we would position it wherever we needed.
Right. Well, we also used that for shadows on the interior for lights. So we would brush, we would wave that branch in front of a light to create a nice forest shadow for the inside shot.
Because the exterior shots have this beautiful, the leaves are moving in the wind and the dappling sun.
Yeah.
And we wanted to create that inside. And then we were trying to create a fake firelight, too, when we were using the candles.
Mm-hmm.
So someone would stand in front of the light and be like...
It's all puppetry.
And that's something you can do in puppetry because the scale is so small. You're just trying to light this one little guy.
Yeah, and the puppets aren't the only ones that look alike.
I wanted to ask Helder, how much, I guess minutes, it's not footage actually, feet anymore, but how many minutes of video or film, one could say, did you have at the end of the shooting, and then you ended up with 18 or so minutes of film. How do you deal with that ratio and the processing of that?
I mean, it was
assuming it's an enormous amount of footage.
It was about 2-3 hours worth of raw.
I mean, if you think about it, we did 4 or 5 shots for every 4 or 5
It was like 250 gigabytes on my hard drive. That's all I remember. So, and cutting it down to 18 minutes was, we had to be very... We started just cutting stuff to make sure it worked well. Like there were some shots that we let drag on too long to film, like the feet on the bridge that some of them looked really nice.
Yeah, that's the hardest part for me.
Oh,
I just love that shot so much, but
yeah, there's like shots where it's like the light's just right, but yeah, you can't really use it. And there was like one shot of bird in the sunlight that looked better, but at the same time, it's like. Doesn't convey exactly. Yeah, the head would bob. Go out of focus and then drag the dots. It came down to what best served the story, what best served the final product, and we knew. Thankfully, we had a great script to go by and a great like storyboard to go by to know this is what really needs to happen to make the story flow. That cutting it down to the 18 minutes was difficult, but still. Feasible. We lost a lot of footage, but not that much. I think we were pretty on point. The only time footage seemed excessive was, I think the marionettes were the difficult ones, and there were a couple of grounders that were pains in the butts. But other than that, we were pretty good.
And we didn't record any sound on set, so that really allowed us a lot
Did you voice the lines of the scenes when you shot?
The puppeteers voiced the lines. So, like a lot of times, Burns' lines would be a completely different puppeteer. You know, there was four or five different puppeteers that did that one character. So then when we went back to do the voiceover, you would hear all those people, and then you're trying to lip sync.
Did you know when you were shooting which voice actors were going to be doing the voicing the puppets? Sorry?
You told me pretty early on that, like, you're going to voice this guy.
Oh, then yes. Did I say that to you, John?
No.
I didn't even know Noelle at that time, so.
I think I know there was a different voice we wanted for.
Really?
We tossed it.
I wanted to go to questions and comments from the audience, but before that I wanted to ask each of you what kinds of puppet film projects are you thinking of next, or also what might be the future life of this film?
I mean, ideally for this film we should get it sent out a little bit more and shot in a few different spots.
Yeah, I'd love to show it. Just now send it to apply to different festivals.
And as far as future puppet films, Paul and I have discussed a couple of ideas that we've talked about.
Sarah, what about you? I know you're at the puppet showplace. You've been doing workshops with film, with kids, puppet film. But I know you've been doing a lot of live work too.
That's something I'm interested in doing at puppet showplace eventually, is doing maybe some puppet filmmaking workshops. Right now we're doing I'm actually teaching a peephole puppet show workshop, which is really fun, and in micro theater. Sounds better. But I think for future puppet films, I'm always looking and thinking of them. I have one in mind that is called, the working title is Why Women Should Rule the World. That will come up. It's set in a bathroom.
Great. So, very, very interesting. Are there questions or comments from the audience, including in the world of the interwebs? Yes, sir.
So I noticed to create a sense of scale, you use depth of field a lot with the cameras. Was there anything else you did in order to try to make everything feel the same way that a human would?
Well, I think I was looking at you because the height of the camera was so important, you know, to shoot at the eye level of the character, to put the audience at that level rather than looking down on a bird because it's small.
Yeah.
You're looking up at them a lot, especially because of the we don't want to see into the hole where the puppeteers are. So a lot of times we're shooting just at a very gentle up angle so that we don't see those openings in the set.
Yeah, there's also a lot of tight. I try to keep all the shots really tight and make it feel really intimate with the characters. To also give you that depth, sense of scale and depth of field.
Right, and to avoid shooting them only in that lower third.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a tendency to do that because it's comfortable. But
the
yeah,
lower third of the screen?
Of the
mean?
Screen.
Yeah,
and
but
to
just
really
the
really get them up
in,
into the frame.
Right.
I mean, they're the characters, they're the main thing. So you want them to be part of it and just, you know, treat them like real actors and real characters and that. So my thing is to just give them really nice, tight close-ups. And when we had, this is what the legs look like, by the way, which was also fun to, like, show the legs.
Yeah, And that's something that made the fill out,
yeah.
Right? Like we're
yeah.
talking about.
Like
cut up.
The props help a lot too, to really drive home the sense of them in their world.
Those were real tasty.
Is the fact that you're shooting on a much smaller scale. If you had a human walking across the bridge, it would be much larger scale. Does that affect the lenses you use?
No,
or
it's just using the same lenses that
okay.
I would be using for everything. No, I didn't use any macro lenses for it, I don't think. It's just pretty much the standard lenses. It just get nice and close, so it opened a little bit more telephoto than only a few wide shots, because anytime we would do wide shots, we run the risk of like seeing the hole, seeing underneath, seeing an arm, seeing too much of a, like the big danger of when we have the marionettes and the controller drop in. So we had to like extend the strings on that. But yeah, so lots of tight shots, close-ups, and
yeah.
Tight frames.
I think the proper framing really drives home the scale.
Other questions, other comments, questions? Yes, ma'am.
How do you start planning when you started doing puppetry on film? How do you start planning to plan that? Because it seems like you have a lot of organization going on, and there's so much you need to know to be able to plan out what you need to make a film successful,
right?
Finish it. How do you start?
The first thing you do is storyboard the script. The storyboards will tell you everything. The storyboards tell you location, they tell you lenses, they tell you shots, they tell you what order you're going to be filming in. And when you cut that up into an order, it's my film school background that I brought to this, which is, you know, you make a giant list of all the shots, and those are first by location, and then from location you group them. And we actually, in order to really know, because we're shooting all around these characters, we actually had to make a map of the, man, I do have everything. We actually did have to make a map, like a shooting map of, from above, of
the
village, thank you, yeah. And so we made a bunch of copies of this, and this is how we were able to place all of our camera angles for each shot. So I remember this was for scene 3, and we've got a shot here, a shot here, a shot here, 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 here. And so we'd go 1, 2, and I would number these by the easiest order, and these are all our wides for mediums. But yeah, in scene 3. This is a breakup of scene 3. So that's kind of how that happened.
Once you storyboard, then you really you're learning to make some decisions that can allow you to do a lot of planning.
Yes, a question?
All right.
I'm sorry,
I couldn't
look
hear.
Look how long ago.
I'm sorry?
Who did the voices of the characters?
I did a voice.
Yeah.
Kayla did the voice.
You did one.
Could you tell us which voices you did, Kayla?
I was the mean man.
Yeah.
Okay.
The mayor,
Caleb,
right?
Caleb was the village leader.
Elder.
The elder.
The village.
Dooper.
and who else except John Cody? Could you remind us?
I played Vern, the main, I guess.
The main, the star.
I was the star of the film. and I will be compensated as such.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because
I
was going to say John Cody also portrayed very different characters on set. Like they were different puppeteers,
characters,
not just the characters that they voiced.
The puppet performance was pretty random.
And Noelle Williams on the end of the row here played, I forget.
Marzen.
And who was the other?
Zach was in there.
I was one of the villagers.
Sarah's voice was in there. My voice was in there. We played villagers, and then a bunch of other students who pitched in at the last minute when we needed like that. Hooray! And a bunch we called a bunch outside where we were recording audio, and we just were like, okay, celebrate! Yay!
That was cool too. When we did the audio, we recorded outside, not in the studio.
Right.
So,
what effect did that have? What difference did that make?
Well, I hired a very talented sound designer, Ken Wilkinson, who also worked on Sarah's project. And so, he built, with help from some Foley artists that he hired, he built the audio from zero. So, he recorded ambiance in the forest where we were shooting, and then we recorded the voices outside so that they also matched that same feeling, so it didn't sound like they were recording in a studio. And then he hired some professional Foley people to create the footsteps and the rustling and the whatever other sounds are in there.
Right.
And then he mixed it all together, and then my brother wrote and performed all of the music and sent me the music, and then I was like, okay, I want this song here, this song there, and then Ken mixed all that into the final thing and then sent us a file, and Elder was able to drop, and so Ken worked from a almost final edit of the film, so everything was there in perfect timing, so I just dropped it into the movie and be almost done.
Yes.
I remember when I was still producing television commercials in New York a long time ago, we would always have room tones recorded. Everybody would be absolutely silent, and there would be a moment when that would be done before we could finish shooting for the day.
Yeah.
So that was important, very, very important to have that piece as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when we were shooting triples, they would do that.
Yeah, we also notated if the scene needed to have dialogue as a scratch track for the voiceover to match it later.
Other questions from yes, Noel.
This is more probably well, I guess for both of you guys. When you're coming up with your film ideas, do you feel like you start with the character who has a story to tell?
Yeah, I started with, I want to tell Star Wars, but not Star Wars. So, Marsan, or Burn is Luke, and Marsan is Yoda, and the village leader is, I don't know who that is. And so, and there's a certain formula. So I was having fun overlaying my story over this hero's journey formula that is laid out in the Joseph Campbell books. So that was how I built this. So it was kind of neither for me, but yeah.
I mean, my first idea, if we're talking about triples, my first idea for triples, I remember I knew I wanted to do it to be talented. I knew it was going to be empowering girls. I didn't know what the concept was, and I remember thinking, what if there were creatures that lived in the trees that helped kids with social problems, but adults never saw them. So that, and then, yeah, that's kind of how I started. But I feel like character is so huge. If you can find a great character first and build a world around them, that's,
Graceful.
Not as graceful.
Okay. I can try again. So you guys.
All right, if you can try again one more time.
So I'll flap at the beginning, but at the end, I think I'm going to not flap.
Yeah, just a couple.
Please come. Thank you so much for being part of this event.